Broadcasting from the business capital of the world, this is the Podcast Business News Network. And welcome back, everybody. Appreciate you being here today. We are going to talk to a gentleman who has dedicated his life in many different areas, and most recently in the last number of years, to providing what's needed to improve education. And part of that today is inner city students, some of the struggles that are going on in many areas of the country, connected with economic situations and such. But it's amazing how he didn't truly begin there. He was all about making sure that the healthcare system in the greater Boston area was the best it could be. Started a company called Healthcare Value Management. He was the president and co-founder, worked for many, many different companies along the way there, focused on unions as well, and really changed the face of healthcare. He still has his finger on the pulse of that, but he's also looking at education as well. He's our Centurion recipient. Charles L. Donahue Jr. is with us. Charles, welcome back. How are you doing today?
Very good, Stephen. Great to be with you.
Wonderful to have you back here. I know that we talked a little bit about the inner city situation and students. I'd love to dig back into that and get your overall thoughts on what's happening there and what, in your view, is being done to help many of these students.
Be happy to. I was fortunate enough to be a member of my local public school committee. I had to get elected to do that. And as a part of that, I began exploring how we can improve education. But I believe this could be done by a public school that I'm going to talk about. It could be done by the YMCA or a YWCA or a boys club or a girls club. Education can be done any place. We have committed adults who are a little bit intelligent. It could be done by grandparents or parents. And I'm just going to be talking about something that I was involved with that paid off. I was asked to sit with the public school system that I served in to discuss with them something, idea that they had. It was a teacher's idea. But again, what I'm going to discuss could be done by public school teachers, could be done by a group of parents, it could be done by a coach of a hockey team, a coach of a football team, a coach of a basketball team, somebody that likes to educate students that are on their teams. I was asked to sit down with some local teachers who had an idea. I was very impressed with how brilliant and how smart these teachers were. They could have been entrepreneurs, they could have set their own companies up. The idea they had was the last week of school for public schools, and it's probably true for a lot of people, are kind of boring. The last week of school, all the grades are in. The seniors have left school. They've already graduated. So you get the freshmen, sophomores, and juniors, and the teachers find it very boring. It's very hot, and it's difficult to teach anything. So they came up with an idea to have a J term. The last week of school, they would have a J term. And during that 1 week, they would teach one class every day, all day, for that week. That was the idea they had.
Wow.
Some of the members of the school committee weren't too pleased with this. They thought this was kind of not a great idea. But I listened to them carefully, and I became their big supporter. And we got it through. What would this J term be like? Well, I've already talked about the great courses that are available in our library. You could buy them and donate it to your library. Donate these are already prepared courses. You could give this to your YMCA or your YWCA, or you could give it to the Boys and Girls Club. You can get these courses. I talked about them previous lecture. They're already college lectures. They're 24 lectures, and they are about a half an hour each. You could do one of those courses for a week. A kid could take one freshman year, one junior, one senior year, apply to college. They'd say when they're doing their college essay or they're doing their college interview, they could say, I've already taken three courses, three history courses, three literature courses. That would greatly enhance anybody trying to get into college. that you've already taken college courses from the great courses, which we talked about last time. We talked about how some of them were available for $15.
Mm-hmm.
They're usually about $500. What were some of the J terms that these teachers came up with that they would teach with no added cost, no added charge? One of the ideas was they would climb the three mountains of New England. They'd go up to New Hampshire and Vermont, and they'd camp out in tents with the teachers and the students. And then they'd climb the mountain. That was a course. A second course was they would basically get a scuba diving license. They'd go to the town pool. They'd go 2 days to the town pool, and they'd do all the exercises you got to do to pass the scuba diving license. They'd spend 3 days down at a local beach diving. Another class would be the class Boston every day, take a train in and visit the major museums in Boston. Another class was you would go to a local restaurant, you'd work in the kitchen, and be taught how to prepare meals. So those are just the types of courses they came up with. The only problem with it, the parents wanted to take the courses. The seniors wanted to come back to school to take the courses. But they came up with very innovative courses. Some were subjects, but some were some of the innovative things that I've just mentioned. Another thing that was available to the students in this local school before I joined it, but I participated in it and learned from it, was a student independent study project. If you're a junior, you can submit to a committee an idea you have for your senior year. You would get 2 credits for it, but it's an idea that has to be defended and proven. With this idea, you would get a local teacher to work with you, and somebody in the town, somebody in the area, would work with you as a student. One of the students had an idea. He said, in high school, you take mathematics, you take algebra, calculus, all these mathematics courses are wonderful if you're going to be an engineer. But you don't get the practical mathematics that you need as an 18-year-old. You're not taught how you get credit. You're not taught how you get a car loan. You're not taught 4 years later when you're graduating maybe from college, how do you basically, what's a 401k? How do you invest your money? So this kid, he had an idea that he wanted to go out and take a course and come back to the school and teach it. So he was approved. He went out and he got worked with a local person who did work with people doing estate planning types of things. He brought the student in. He let the student sit in the classes that he had, teaching people how to invest their money, how to save their money. He then wrote up a course on all the topics that were in it. Another student had an idea. He wanted to help his father's construction company. He used to work for the father's construction company every year. He said, "Dad, you need a web page. You need to advertise what you can build. You build porches for people. You did additions to their kitchens and their houses. Need a web page." The father says, "I got a sign on my truck. I don't know what a web page is. I don't need a web." So he worked with a web construction company who helped them develop a web page for the construction company. The only problem the father had was he had to go out and hire about 5 people to work for him. He got so much business.
Good problem to have.
People say, "I want the porch that you did. I want the screened in thing that you did. I loved what was on your website." Another kid or girl, she wanted to learn about writing legislation, so she wrote a proposal to work with a local member of the state legislature. She got a job working on weekends. Was in there working for the state legislature, and she got a chance to write legislation that she defended and she brought before the whole Massachusetts legislature on changes that they wanted to make. So that's a second project that's not too far apart, where you come up with an idea and you get to work with local people who help you take that idea to fruition. So the J term is a wonderful idea on what you could do. But you could do this in a YMCA. You can do it in a Boys and Girls Club. You just need an adult to come in with an idea, come in to say, we're going to do this as a project. It could be done by a public school. If your teacher's committed to do something very different, but very interesting. So that's just the J-Term, Student Independent Study Project. And we talked about last week about the great courses that already are available to be bought, to be streamed. But these are things that you could do as a course for a week, not just in the school, but you could begin doing these and making the YMCA and the YWCA, the Boys Club, a place where a team could be taught. A teacher could go in there, or a parent could go in there. A parent who's a lawyer could go in there, or a teacher. They could go to the YMCA if they can't do this in their school. They could bring it in and tell the students, these are the courses that we're going to be having. So I think there's wonderful ways to develop teaching at Boys and Girls Clubs and YMCAs. In addition to the public schools, you just got to get dedicated teachers that want to do these extra things.
Mm.
So those are just things I'd like to mention that I would strongly recommend. A grandparent could do this. A parent could do this. A parent who's retired could start doing this at the YMCA, at the YWCA, at the Boys and Girls Club. Say that I'd like to start teaching here. And I have a room, and we'll publicize it, and we'll let kids know. Or the coach of a team would like to do this, give the kids something else in addition to learning how to play a sport. So those are just things that I'd be happy at some future time to answer questions on. But I think it'd be a wonderful way to allow inner-city kids to get access to a lot more education and right available college courses in the Great Courses program.
Love it. And I want to bring up volunteerism and how it can be so impactful in terms of a certain feeling that you get, gratification, helping others. Now, this is something that you harnessed the power of many, many, many years ago by joining the Peace Corps. Tell us about how it feels to volunteer and how you think it moves people forward.
Well, I was always impressed with my father, who was in the Navy during World War II. He was in the South Pacific. He was in 9 major sea battles, got torpedoed twice. And I always admired him and all the men who volunteered during the World War II and the work they did. My father, when he came home, he was asked by the local town I lived in, by the Knights of Columbus, that they were having after Mass one day, they're going to have a local politician come out. But he wanted to talk to somebody from the town. So he asked my father to go into Boston to meet with this young politician who was just getting started. And my father went in. He told me how he went in, and he was in Beacon Hill in Boston, and he went to the apartment of this young guy running for office.
Mm-hmm.
He went into his kitchen. He had coffee and they talked. And in those days, you said to another guy, where did you serve? My father said, I served in the South Pacific. This guy said, I served in the South Pacific too. So they went on talking. But the young guy who my father went in to talk to was John Kennedy, the future president of the United States, who served in the South Pacific, was a PT boat, and has a PT boat sunk. So my father used to tell me these stories. We used to watch Victory at Sea on the television all the time. My father would tell me all about these battles and what the battles were about and all this. And so I became very, very interested in serving, like my father did and so many other people did during the Second World War. Then I suddenly began to get a feeling when President Kennedy started talking about the Peace Corps, about how to ask what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. And I became very interested in that, following his advice and seeing what I could do. When I graduated from college, I was accepted as a a student, I did get into law school right out of college. I was on the waiting list at medical school, and then I decided to apply for the Peace Corps. My father was very upset that I wasn't going to go straight to law school, but when I told him I could always come back and go to law school, but I think I'd like to serve the country. I slowly learned, after I'd been in the Peace Corps for a while, about how the Peace Corps had made an influence and a difference in a lot of places. There's a person I was told who was, he served in Afghanistan in the military, and when he left the military, he was made the ambassador to Afghanistan. He was stationed in Kabul, and one of the things the ambassador was asked to do was to go out and pick up the bodies of soldiers that had been killed by the Taliban. The Taliban would attack American-friendly villages. These were villages in Afghanistan that liked America. So the ambassador goes out, and he goes to the village. And as he arrives at the village, all the headmaster, the people in charge of the government of the village, come up to him, and they ask him if he's in Williams, part of Williams tribe. And the ambassador doesn't know what they're talking about, but he asks his aides to go find out. And they say that these people who are the village leaders in their American-friendly village, which helps the soldiers out to go to an American-friendly village, what they basically, he said, that they said that it's a village. When somebody asks you if you're from the same tribe, everybody in Afghanistan is in a tribe. You're not from New York or Boston, but you're from a tribe. So he found that out. He said, well, why are they interested in a certain tribe? They want Williams' tribe. They said, well, Williams was a Peace Corps volunteer in Afghanistan here 50 years ago. And William was a teacher in the village. He also was on the village council, and he wrote a grant to get water to the village, which is the basis for their economy now. So he's a very famous person, very well-loved by the people here. And the reason they're friendly to our troops and are American-friendly is because of William. So as the ambassador went back to Kabul, the capital, he was wondering how many American-friendly villages are there around the world because of a Peace Corps volunteer. Came in, volunteered their time, spent time with them. So that's what they were trying to get at. He felt the Peace Corps had made major contributions to our military, to other Americans serving in these various parts of the world. One thing I never fully knew, but over 300 Peace Corps volunteers who said goodbye to their families, went to the airport, went into the Peace Corps, over 300 have died away in service of diseases like malaria and dengue fever and accidents and all that. So it's a lot of Peace Corps volunteers have made a major contribution to the country. I myself went to the country of Malaysia to work with tuberculosis patients, and I learned an awful lot that is of value in international health on how do you take care of people in a developing country who speak a different language, have a different culture, have a different religion. How do you make healthcare understandable to them, and how do you make a commitment that can be valuable when you come home? Serving in the United States, there's a lot of parts of the United States where there's different cultures now. A lot of immigrants have come in, and they need to be thought about. One needs to have empathy, understanding their cultures, understanding their values, to get them to use the healthcare system in the United States. So it was very valuable after my service, trying to deal with rural people in isolated areas of Malaysia. Malaysia is a Muslim country. It was important to learn all about Islam and its values. And it was a great opportunity to learn how do you take care of people in a different culture. Because of that Peace Corps experience, I spent 4 years at Cornell University when I came home, basically trying to understand and learn a lot about healthcare and how can you provide healthcare to many different types of people. through a program called Community Health Planning. It was a program the federal government wanted to get involved with, which was to teach people like myself what we needed to learn about data, how to use data, how to understand data, how we could make a difference in areas which physicians weren't studying. They weren't teaching doctors about epidemiology, about variations in hospital use, about how those data could be helpful to their work. And I think I spent a lot of time studying things like why is it the infant mortality rate in the United States higher than most of the developing countries in the world. I spent time at Cornell studying that issue. I got to go to Europe to study why we spend the most money and have the highest infant mortality. But from that study, I ended up publishing my first paper in the Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology, which was later used in Boston by obstetricians and people. They took my data, and it helped them begin to understand how can they find women very early in the prenatal care period when you should be finding diabetes early on, not at the end of the pregnancy. You should be find women very early who've had previous pregnancy problems. So I learned a lot at Cornell that I used later in a career in a field called health planning, where we gathered data, we published our data, we gave the data that we published was used by physicians to be better at finding unnecessary C-sections, unnecessary surgery. We began to work closely with physicians, helping them look at areas they had never learned about or never studied. And we had the Peace Corps in graduate school at Cornell allowed me a lot to become much more effective in the Peace Corps. Allowed me a lot more to write about. So one of the papers that I wrote for the Boston University School of Public Health, I've just written six papers for them, for the students that are interested in changing the health system. So one of my papers I wrote about was tuberculosis control in Malaysia and what I did about it. And hopefully that'll help because tuberculosis is still a very major health problem in developing countries. And Boston University has a lot of kids coming in to go to school there from India, from various African countries, South American countries, from China, and they may benefit from what I have to say about dealing with tuberculosis.
Well, I'll tell you one word, Charles, that stands out for me, and you said it before, is empathy, and how that's important, especially when you're viewing other cultures. In all areas, you have such a tremendous amount of empathy. And that's why you do what you do, and your wife and you do what you do in terms of improving our education system. And, of course, our healthcare system. Truly appreciate you and all the insight and the inspiration, too, for many of us to get out there and volunteer. It's going to make you feel good. It's going to help others. And one more reason why you're our Centurion recipient. And I appreciate you being here today. Really do, Charles.
Stephen, always a pleasure to talk with you.
You too. We'll be right back.
Broadcasting from the business capital of the world, this is the Podcast Business News Network.
It's Thursday night, and you're grabbing drinks with some friends. Started off with a pitcher for the table, which quickly becomes two. There's pool. And there's the photo booth.
All right, everybody, squeeze in. Say cheese!
Followed naturally by an order of wings. And another.
Can we get some extra ranch sauce?
Then there's the ceremonial nightcap.
So what are we doing this weekend?
And lastly, it's back to the car, which, if you're buzzed... could be the most expensive night of your life. Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.